When a UK police officer seized a Cybertruck near Manchester last month, the EV world collectively gasped. But here's what's fascinating. This wasn't just some paperwork mishap. Look, I've spent years analysing EV regulations, and what I'm about to share isn't just another Cybertruck controversy story. This is about fundamental engineering decisions that make Tesla's latest creation literally illegal on British roads. But before we dive in, let me drop a number that will blow your mind. The Cybertruck weighs 6,898 pounds. That's not just heavy, it's literally too heavy for most UK drivers to legally operate. And that's just the beginning. Now, I know what you're thinking, Des, surely Tesla just needs to make it right-hand drive, right? If only it was that simple. You see, the real story here is way more fascinating. We're talking about five fundamental engineering decisions that clash with UK safety standards in a way that Tesla's engineers absolutely saw coming. And wait until you hear what Tesla's VP let slip about the steel they used. So, let's get into this, guys. Let's start with the most visible issue, those edges. The UK law requires a minimum of 3.2 millimeters round shape for any protruding parts. And the Cybertruck, well, it's basically a geometry teacher's nightmare of acute angles. Now, this isn't just about aesthetics. In 2023, the UK recorded over 16,000 pedestrian collisions. You see, those rounded edges we see on every other vehicle, they're literally designed to give pedestrians a fighting chance in an impact. But here's what most people miss. These aren't just design choices. These are integral to the entire exoskeleton concept. You see, the angular design is fundamental to the Cybertruck's structural integrity. You see, you can't just soften these edges without compromising the entire unibody design. Look at this comparison with a standard vehicle front end. See how traditional cars use multiple layers of deformation zones. The Cybertruck's edges are actually load-bearing elements, and modifying them would require re-engineering the entire pressure distribution system. But here's what's really wild. Tesla's actually patented this exact edge design in a market where it's literally illegal to use it. Now, the front edge alone has seven distinct impact points that would need complete redesign. And we're not talking about a simple modification here either. We're looking at fundamental structural changes that would essentially create an entirely different vehicle. And do you remember when everyone was drooling over those fancy LED light bars? Well, there's a slight problem. They don't meet UK lighting regulations at all. So let's get technical for a quick moment. You see, UK regulations require specific luminosity levels, precise positioning, and particular visibility angles for all vehicle lighting. And the Cybertruck's continuous LED bar, unfortunately, it breaks six different requirements in one sleek package. You see, traditional vehicles have individually housed light units for a reason. And what I researched and what I found is that each function, indicators, brake lights, running lights, needs specific positioning and separation. Now, the Cybertruck's integrated design might look fantastic, but it creates serious visibility issues from certain angles. And here's where it gets really interesting, because the software-controlled lighting system, while innovative, it doesn't provide the mandatory redundancy UK regulations actually demand. And if that central computer fails, you're essentially driving a dark polygon. But here's what fascinates me most. Tesla actually filed patents for UK-compliant lighting systems, and they didn't use them, unfortunately. So let's talk about why. Retrofitting compliant lighting wouldn't just mean new bulbs. You see, we're talking about a structural modification to the entire front and rear sections. And the estimated cost, you're talking about around 15,000 per vehicle. That's £15,000. And that's assuming you can even modify that steel body. And speaking of steel, Tesla's VP proudly announced they're using 30X cold rolled stainless steel, which sounds pretty impressive, right? But here's the problem. In an actual crash, you don't actually want your car to be as rigid as a tank. So for those of you that are science nerds, let me break it down. A normal car's body is designed to crumple like an accordion, absorbing impact energy. Tesla's 30X steel is about three times harder than the standard automotive steel. Now in the UK, that's not a feature. It's a fundamental safety issue, unfortunately. Now, should automakers have the freedom to push design boundaries, or should safety regulations emissions be the ultimate priority? Let me know in the comments below. And also, what's your experience with vehicle safety features? Do you know anything about it? If you do, let me know in the comments. So just watch this demonstration. You see, standard automotive steel deforms under specific pressures, but the Cybertruck steel, it resists deformation until a catastrophic failure. And in crash test terms, this means instead of absorbing energy, it transfers it directly to the passenger compartment. But the thing is, UK safety standards have specific requirements for how a vehicle structure should behave in a collision. And this is based on decades, and I mean decades, of safety research. And the Cybertruck's exoskeleton design, it essentially throws that playbook out of the window. And here's the real kicker. Tesla actually knows this. But you know what? Between you and me, I don't think they were ever looking to market the Cybertruck in the UK. You see, internal documents show that they considered a more compliant steel composition, but rejected it for aesthetic reasons. And I can see why, to be fair. The steel choice wasn't just about strength, it was about making a statement. That's what they wanted to do in real terms, just make a massive statement. But in the UK market, that statement roughly translates to, sorry, we're not street legal. And do you remember that weight number that I mentioned earlier? The Cyberbeast model hits 6,898 pounds, that's 3.1 tons. And if you're wondering, here's why this matters. In the UK, if you pass your driving test after 1997, you need a special license to drive anything over 3.5 tons. But wait, I hear you say, 3.1 tons is under 3.5, right? Well, that's before you add passengers, cargo, on that massive steel trailer Tesla promotes. One family trip to Cornwall and you're potentially driving illegally. Now let's talk about what happens when you combine that mass with instant torque. You see, the Cybertruck can hit 60 miles per hour in 2.6 seconds. That's supercar territory in something that weighs more than two Honda Civics. And here's what the NTSB chair, Jennifer Homendy, said, and I quote, "The Cybertruck is an over 6,000 pound piece of steel that has no business going a quarter of a mile under 11 seconds. Now consider this, the average UK road lane is 3 meters wide and the Cybertruck is actually 2.2 meters wide. And for you math geniuses out there, that leaves just 40 centimeters of clearance in total. Now imagine that mass moving at speed through our historic town centers. Now this final issue might just be the most crucial. You see, standard cars have crumple zones that deform that 70 to 100 millimeters in a crash. But the Cybertruck, its exoskeleton design fundamentally changes this safety principle. Let's look at a standard vehicle crash test. Can you see how the front end progressively collapses? Now, most of you probably know that's actually by design. It's absorbing energy that would otherwise reach the passengers. Now watch the Cybertruck test. Do you notice anything different? You see, the exoskeleton design means impact forces travel differently. And instead of controlled deformation, we're seeing rigid body displacement. And in engineering terms, that's like turning a crash cushion into a battering ram. But here's what really keeps safety engineers up at night. It's not just about Cybertruck occupants. Just think about what happens when this 3.1 ton rigid structure impacts a standard UK vehicle. Now, European vehicle standards were developed through decades of research and thousands of crash tests. And they're actually based on a principle of mutual compatibility, vehicles that protect both their occupants and others on the road. But in a collision, the Cybertruck's mass and rigidity create forces that most UK vehicles simply aren't designed to withstand. We're talking about impact forces up to 50% higher than in typical vehicle-to-vehicle collisions. So a quick question for you guys. When does vehicle innovation cross the line between impressive and irresponsible? Now, I'm not trying to lead you any way. I'm actually a big fan of the Cybertruck. But let me know in the comments what you think. Have you ever encountered a vehicle that you feel is unsafe for UK roads? If you have, leave a comment down below. So, you know the bit I like numbers. Tesla currently holds about 10 to 12% of the UK EV sales. This ban isn't just a PR nightmare, it's a calculated market decision in my opinion. You see, the UK's EV market grew 31% last year with over 320,000 new registrations. But here's what's fascinating about pickup trucks. I don't know if you actually knew this, but they actually represent less than 1% of total vehicle sales in the UK, so it's pretty minuscule. This isn't Texas, it's not Australia, we're a nation of hatchbacks and small SUVs. Just how well do you think American vehicle designs actually translate to UK roads? And what's your experience with US vehicles in Britain? If you have experience, let me know in the comments. And the real winners here are actually European manufacturers who've been quietly watching this unfold. Look at what Volkswagen and BMW are actually doing. You see, while Tesla was designing the Cybertruck for US regulations, European manufacturers were developing vehicles specifically for our market. Even the Hyundai Ioniq 5, all designed with UK and EU regulations as a priority. And the numbers tell a really interesting story. You see, Tesla's potential market loss, a conservative estimate puts it about 450 million in lost sales over the next 3 years. So it's not massive, let's be fair. But on the other hand, that's probably not the real cost. And here's the truth that no one is talking about. The Cybertruck isn't just banned in the UK, it's facing similar challenges all across Europe. This isn't a single market issue, it's a glimpse into the future of global EV regulations. And just think about it. You see, while Tesla was pushing boundaries with the Cybertruck, they were also pushing against decades of safety, research, and regulatory evolution. And sometimes, innovation means knowing which rules you can break and which ones exist for very good reasons. But here's what fascinates me most about this situation. Tesla might have accidentally done the UK EV market a huge favour. You see, by highlighting these safety standards so dramatically, they've sparked a crucial conversation about EV design philosophy. Should we be building vehicles that prioritise shock value over safety? Or should we focus on innovations that work within proven safety frameworks? That's not my view, but I'd love to hear your view on it. You see, the Cybertruck isn't just a vehicle, it's a wake-up call for the entire industry. And maybe, just maybe, that's more valuable than another electric pickup on British roads. Is it for the UK industry? Now, I've got to say, I'm a massive fan of the Cybertruck. I'm a Tesla shareholder. I'm a big fan of Tesla cars. I actually don't think it's actually designed for UK roads. Let's be fair. It's designed for US roads, designed for Australian roads, maybe Canadian roads. It's not designed for UK roads. So let's just be honest with ourselves. I don't actually have a problem if somebody wants to ship one over here and make all the little modifications that they want to make. I haven't got a problem with that at all. It's their money. I actually believe Yanni purchased one. He was trying to rebuild his for UK roads. I'll leave a link in the description of one of his videos, and it's actually quite interesting how he got on with it actually. So, do you want to stay ahead of the EV curve? Every Thursday, I send out a comprehensive analysis of the week's biggest developments in the electric vehicle space. From breaking technical innovations to market movements that matter, the Electric Oracle Weekly delivers the insights you need straight to your inbox. It's free, it's focused, and it's made for people who want to understand where the industry is really heading. Guys, if you're interested, you'll find the sign-up link in the description below. My name's Des from the Electric Oracle. Thank you so much for watching this video. I appreciate every person that watches my videos. I appreciate if you'd like and subscribe. If you like this video, I'll see you in the next video.